things like that that are geared towards families that don't cost a lot of money to take your family out for the night. I would love to just see things like that that could really expand the quality of living in Twin Falls that will go with our growth. My driving force, I was a policy council Head Start president, and that was probably my first leadership role, and I've always wanted to grow from there, and I feel like city council for Twin Falls would be a great place to start and get to know the inside of how things work and be able to bring all my skills into that role.
Well, maybe moving back this way, so putting you on the spot again. What do you see as the biggest issue facing our city government? And how would you address this issue if you were elected?
There's quite a few things that I would love to see addressed. I think traffic, the streets haven't progressed quite as fast as the rest of the town has. So I think that putting in an efficient system with the traffic lights and stop signs and really thinking about that strategically to help traffic flow a lot better. And I know we've talked about mass transit in the past, but the Wood River Valley really has a great system where kids can jump on and go to their friend's house or go to their different practices. And I think something like that would really cut down on a lot of the traffic that we have on Blue Lakes and the other roads that really can't take all of the influx of traffic that we have. So I think that would save a lot on expanding the road system, just coming up with a better strategic plan with the systems we already have, like streetlights and stop signs and things like that. And also a recycling program. I think we're underutilizing a lot of the resources that we have, and I think we can put those back into the community in a way that benefits us as a whole. So I would like to see something like that also.
I think one of the biggest issue we have is the Silverheads issue. It's a portion of lives of 174 babies are being taken in our city every year, the last statistic that I've seen. So I think we should protect the life of those unborn children that have done nothing wrong. And I think to do that, all we could do as a city council would be to pass a city ordinance that outlawed it. I know that's highly contentious, but it's what I think would be best for her. Our local city, and one of the reasons is I know everybody's looking for workers, but as a nation, we've killed 60 million babies over the last 30, 40 years, or 70, I'm trying to think how many years, so since Roe versus Wade, killed 60 million, and now we're having issues with not having enough labor. So, I mean, you can connect the dots. If we had those 60 million people, maybe not all of them are at age now, would be at age now that they would be able to help us with our labor issue.
Well, I'm a note taker, so I have a lot of stuff in here related to Twin Falls. I've seen a lot of these issues on planning and zoning, and I guess the number one is explosive growth in the city of Twin Falls. And related to that is affordable housing. There's a good balance, but talking to realtors this last couple of months, the one thing that they always have been saying lately is we've priced our local citizens out of the market. It doesn't mean that incomers or out-of-staters are bad, it just means that the prices have gone up enough that, for instance, my wife's colleagues, school teachers, can't afford to buy a house in town, and that's pretty sad. They're servicing our children, they're helping our community. There are ways that city council can partner with the government or partner with developers. And there was even an article in the Times News just recently on Saturday regarding kind of a for sale for rent kind of project where you could rent a new home and still be affordable. Millennials and baby boomers are our largest demographic. And right now they can't afford a home, or the millennials, they can't afford a down payment. And this was an opportunity for affordable housing to, you know, allow them to live here, work here, in which we need, of course, labor. So that is the other short. The city of Twin Falls itself is short on labor. Right now they're trying to find ways to hire people, just like every other business, my business that I work for included. We've had to shut down two of our facilities this year because we don't have enough staff. So it's an issue. but it's an issue that comes with growth, so it's not necessarily a bad thing, as they say. It's a good thing because people are getting more money for their housing. It's a good thing that we need more labor, we need more skilled labor. I could go on and on and on about all this stuff that we, that city council has the ability to change or help with.
I think, again, for me, it really, the biggest issue is that growth component to what our community is seeing. Obviously, the state of Idaho in itself has been discovered. There are a lot of people moving in or changing counties or whatever it may be. And so we see that in the city of Twin Falls as well. There's no exception to that. But I think I take it from the engineering perspective of what does that do to our infrastructure? What does that do to our water, to our wastewater, to our roads? And how that impacts us. We grow from about 52,000 residents a day to well over 80, and in some instances to 100,000 people a day. So that in itself takes a toll on our emergency response, our police, our fire, their ability to respond throughout the city. And so as a city council member, we need to make sure that we're planning for that growth. We understand that it's probably going to continue for some time. And making sure that we're being thoughtful, that we're taking residents' input into that, and looking at what are the residents of Twin Falls looking for as we can continue to experience that growth. But really taking care of the infrastructure so we have the ability to continue that growth. Also, again, I think not forgetting our heritage. The Magic Valley is a place that people came to be prosperous, to grow, and that started from agriculture, but we also have small businesses in this town, and we need to recognize their importance to our viability economically going forward. So working with them and that community, but also not forgetting our heritage as an agricultural society here in Southern Idaho.
I'm here.
I'd just like to coattail off of Mr. Kelly, Mr. Brown. The growth kind of relates to a culture shift going on in Twin Falls right now, where we have long-term residents that are experiencing changes brought on by new influx of people, part of it promoted by FOMO, which is fear of missing out on buying a house or selling a house, making a profit, getting what you want, etc. Eventually that will taper off. But this impact has caused infrastructure issues, as already talked about, some of which we will need help from other sources such as the state or feds, with getting different routes set up throughout the city because the roads are such a jurisdictional nightmare on who has control, who has say, what can you do, what can you not do. So help be a pain in the other individuals involved would be part of it. As far as the job shortage, what we're facing as part of it is the new residents that are coming are not contributing to our workforce because some are able to work from home and that job may not necessarily represent a job or a skill in Twin. Some people moving here are retired. They're not going to contribute to the workforce. And others are finding different unique ways of making money that don't necessarily fall into a traditional sense of a job. Eventually, we will have a new workforce coming through as these younger families that are moving here, which is the older, they will start filling these voids. But we have to adapt Twin to fit the needs of our long-term resident elders that are concerned with Twin maintaining its history, maintaining its culture. And the newer residents, the next generation, I think the average age of Twin is 32, 33, somewhere in there. And their needs are different than our 50s or 60s or 70, even our 80-year-olds that have a say and a stake in what the city does or doesn't do. And so basically, the city council needs to listen to everybody, and that's all people really want to know, is that they're being heard and they're being evaluated. And the city is willing to adapt as it needs to.
Okay, thank you. So our next question is, what, in your view, is the appropriate role of city government in relation to sometimes highly controversial national or state issues, such as abortion, gun, immigration, regulation?
So, being a teacher, I hate social media, and a lot of our issues are, as we
it's you know, I think the national issues obviously are more exciting to talk about than our roads and our streets and our wastewater. But I think there are we need to stay within the bounds that we can control as the city of Twin Falls. I think we obviously all have our opinions about the national issues, but we really need to focus and focus our energy as the council on the issues that we can control inside of the jurisdiction, but also not be naive to the fact that there are decisions made on the federal and the state level that do impact us, and we need to understand what those are, but also understand that if we go into those arenas, there's going to be a financial cost to the city, potentially from lawsuits or something that we choose to make a decision on. And so we have to be responsible for the monies that are allocated to us as the city of Twin Falls, but really do need to focus on the issues that we can control. And again, those are our streets, our roads, the way people come and through our city, understanding the impact of those growth of how we handle that into the future.
Yeah, I agree with everything that's been said. And I guess to touch on the fact that Idaho is a Dillon rule state, so some of these issues cannot be brought forward basically by law. It doesn't mean they shouldn't be heard, but there are certain issues that the city council just cannot vote on, cannot handle. You guys are correct. We need to focus on our infrastructure, on our city, on our growth. Doesn't mean the citizens can't bring it forward and city council can't listen to it, because they need to be transparent and hear the voice of the citizens. But keep in mind that city council is limited in some of its power related to federal issues.
I'm pretty clear. I think abortion should be ended. I know it could cost the city money. I don't deny that. But it's a last statistic that I've seen is 174 lives. I think that's priceless. The priceless thing to try to save, and that it'd be well worth protecting even those citizens at the expense of possibly our other taxpayers. I mean, that's what part of local government is the police force and protecting your civil liberties, and yes, and making wise decisions on how to use the money. I don't disagree with a lot of what they said, but when it comes to abortion, I think there should be some defiance. I mean, our nation was built of defiance to King George, even though he had some jurisdiction in your country. So, thank you.
Well, I actually feel like I'm more in the middle. I am a Democrat, but I feel like force has never worked for anybody. And I really think that the way that we handled some of the issues over the last year and a half, Twin Falls as a whole, the Magic Valley, has handled it pretty well overall. I think that we all value and respect each other enough to stay outside of our bubbles and kind of let people kind of do their own thing and make choices that are best for them and their family. And I firmly believe that nobody knows what's best for me. I don't know what's best for everybody else. But I do think that collectively there is a middle ground that we can find, and it doesn't have to be extreme one way or the other, because at the end of the day, we all have to live together. We all have to make it work one way or another, or the fighting is just going to end up tearing us apart. And the dividedness that we've had over the last, you know, several years, but probably more in the last couple, has really made it hard for anybody to see that we're a lot more alike than different. And just finding that common ground and give and take can really go a long way. And I would like to be that person to find that middle ground and bring people together on both sides to say, yeah, we can find a place that we all can agree on. So that's kind of what I'm thinking in those terms.
Thank you. What do you believe is the top responsibility of a council member, and how will you fulfill it?
Definitely listening to the people. I have seen how people are kind of, you know, they definitely want to be heard, just going off of what somebody else said. And I think being heard is true for all of us. Feeling like we're ignored, or that whatever our issue isn't being heard fully, is frustrating and it causes conflict. And I think hearing hearing everybody on a real level and not just hearing the noise, but feeling where they're coming from and understanding that can really bring us to a better place overall. And I think as a councilwoman, I believe that it will not be difficult to bring those resources together and bring everybody to the table.
I think the main purpose was to pass just and fair city ordinances, and also to remove any city ordinances or anything that hampers the free market and allows our market and our economy within the city to flourish as much as possible, and not to promote one part of the economy over another. And the government picks winners kind of like that. It's never good for the economy or for the other people in the society that might not participate in that one section of the economy.
Ultimately, a city councilman has to be true and fair to the city. You make your decisions based on what's best for the city, not necessarily what's best for you or what's related to your business. So transparency, I say it a lot, honest. You have to be committed, not only just attending meetings, but you have to be dedicated to the data that you receive. Do the research, make sure the decisions are good. One of the things you see on planning and zoning is a lot of information, and you have to read through it. May not necessarily be great for me, but you have to move yourself from that and what's good for the city as a whole. Not just citizens and related to special interests, but citizens as a whole, and you have to balance it out. So integrity, honest, commitment. I think that's three good words for a city councilman.
Thanks.
I think the role of city council is to, again, think about what's best for the community at large. Understanding that we have a fiduciary or a financial responsibility to help pass a balanced budget, to help keep a tax rate as low as we possibly can, in pushing and helping the citizens thrive, and not creating policies that will hamper that entrepreneurship that the Magic Valley was based on, and making sure that we are listening to the citizens that have elected us as members of the city council. It's important that we, as citizens in general, take an active role in our government and let our voice be heard in a courteous and a professional manner. But it's really the responsibility of the city council to take care of the tax money that has been allocated to our city and make sure that we're being judicious as possible with that money and being transparent and open with the citizens on where that money goes.
So city council is there to serve, and luckily we have so many that have decided this term to give our shot at serving the citizens of Twin Falls. It's exciting, right? That 5 for seat 1, 4 for seat 5. And all of us, I hope, are willing to use our own backgrounds and what we specialize in, along with the advice from the city manager, the city attorney, all the department heads, and any other experts that are called in, along with the residents that give their opinions during the commenting period within a council meeting, or just an email in general, to help make decisions that are best based with the knowledge that we're given, and to stand by those decisions, not to just tell people what they want to hear, to make the tough decisions that may or may not be popular. The city should be, the councilmen should be doing the budget, making sure that all disciplinary issues are taken care of, making sure we don't violate any open meeting laws. Thankfully, we stream all the services, so if people don't come to the council meetings, they're able to watch those happen live or later on at their own time for meetings. The meeting minutes are always posted and what's going to be on the agenda. And just being able to listen when something is brought to the attention of the council that does need to be discussed or does need to be voted for approval.
Thank you.
Yes.
So city some that you might like to serve on and why?
So I'm from a musician background. I've been playing drums since I was 13. And so I love the trying to promote art within the city. So I'd love to be on all the different commissions for bringing in artists and the competitions that are in our area. Also being a history teacher, I'd love to be in historical districts that local citizens are trying to set up to preserve some of our historical buildings, our historical houses. Historical monuments and traditions,
etc. So those would be the ones that would be great fun to be involved with. I think for me, you know, being involved, continue to be involved in the public works of the infrastructure, but really probably the parks and recreation. I think one of the great things about the city of Twin Falls is our ability to go outside and recreate, and having a vision for what that department can be as our city expands and grows, and how we interface in those community spaces, to me, would be an opportunity to serve for that growth and have a part of that vision, but also be able to implement the plans, the strategic plan that the city has and some of the comprehensive plans that the city has in scoping that future from that department, but obviously staying with the engineering background and understanding how the public infrastructure works, that would be part of what I would be very effective at.
Well, speaking of the Arts Commission, they do have openings on their commission, so they are looking for people desperately, so get involved regardless. Just like I mentioned, the city's always looking for help, so, and that's one that is the heart and soul competition in town is amazing, and I don't think I travel all over the United States and I've never seen anything as unique as that. So that would be one committee I definitely would love to participate in. Urban Renewal Agency is a big one for our downtown area. If you're familiar with everything they're doing right now, there's some big projects coming up that are going to help small business. They're going to preserve our history in town, but kind of move it forward a little bit too. Parking is always an issue wherever you go. So related to that, I think that would be something I'd be interested in, because the downtown, the way it's shaping up, including this building we're in right now, is exciting, because if you've lived here as long as some of us have, you remember when it wasn't so nice. And it's really made a great turnaround in a short amount of time. So preserving our history, making sure downtown's viable, and making sure our business owners are successful would be interesting.
Thank you. With that, my background for working in the federal government and also working as a federal contractor has seen a lot of mismanagement of funds, so any committee I was a part of, I'd be very interested in trying to not have funds mismanaged, and I'd like to be on the planning zoning committee, because I think that historically, and also it's happened quite a few times, they do the most damage to property rights, and I want to try to avoid that. Thank you.
Planning and zoning is definitely one I would like to protect the agriculture, but also bring in farmers markets and things like that that can utilize the schools. So instead of having a lot of processed foods in schools for lunch, create some kind of program where the farmland would be used for the schools, like in a full circle farm-to-table type program, teaching business, kitchen skills, things like that, pretty much every level, but then feeding it to the students instead of processed box foods. I'm not quite sure if there's a committee for that, but I think there should be. Also recycling, and I'm very passionate about recycling. I think that glass recycling is something that is underutilized in most of the country, but there are so many byproducts that you can make with glass. We can make sidewalks out of it, use it in roads. We can sell it as mosaic pieces and use it in schools and use that money to then pay for field trips or things that the schools need, such as art supplies or things that the schools are really lacking because of funding. I think that we can use the things that we throw out and reprocess it and make it a whole business that can really help our community and without shipping it anywhere, and then just put it back into benches and statues, and I mean, there's just so many possibilities. I would love to see a really good recycling program in Twin Falls that we can utilize for a lot of different reasons, not just pumping plastic back through, burning it, and the normal refinery type processes. I think that we can actually make it a really viable business that can supply the community.
Thank you. In conclusion, please give voters a final message to convey why they should have your vote on November 2nd. Let's go down, you have a little bit of time to basically say anything that you'd like to say that you haven't had the opportunity to yet tonight.
Oh, I've been in the Magic Valley for, like I said, quite a few years. I've been a real estate agent. I've seen the town grow. I've also definitely seen locals get pushed out. I've been a credit repair person for a very long time, so I've seen people go from denied to approved, shopping for their home, putting their family in their first home, growing that home, and that is something that I'm really passionate about in terms of local people not being priced out of the market to buy a house and also rent a house. I've seen rent exponentially go up in just a few years, and that is not something any of us who have lived here for a long time are used to. And that change, I think, can cause a lot of other problems in terms of homelessness for locals and things like that, or even locals moving out of state entirely. I've had a lot of friends that can't afford to live here anymore, so they go and buy in a different state. And I don't think any of us really want to raise our kids somewhere that they're not going to be able to put down their own roots with their own family and grow into who they want to be for their whole lives. So I would really like to protect what we have in the Magic Valley in terms of agriculture, like I said, and it's so sad to me that we have so much farmland that's just being taken with houses, which is vital. We definitely need housing in this area, but I think there's a balance that we can find that will give our quality of life a lot higher quality of life.
Thank you for your time, for listening to us. I think one thing that sets me apart is I'm very interested in it being a free market and not the city council trying to manipulate our local economy in any way by putting tax money that's taken from another citizen and putting it where they think is best. I think it's best when private citizens decide to promote businesses with their own money rather than the government taking it, which doesn't really help grow economy because the government can't create any extra wealth. Only private companies really can. So I'm glad we are there.
Yes. Bill, thank you, everyone, for your time tonight. It's great for the citizens to be able to have access in different ways. And thank you for your time. You have to stay here with us. So I've traveled all over the world for my job, and it's always great to come back to Twin Falls. It is cliche to say, but it is really a unique place to live, and I'm excited that there are five people running for C1 that are eager to get involved in the political process, eager to get involved in government, and eager to make some change. One thing you need to do is you need to learn how the government works, and part of that was one of the reasons why I'm on planning and zoning. It gave me an insight on how the process works, and boy, it opened my eyes. And one of the first things we learn when we're on planning and zoning is to protect property rights. You can't take rights away, and that's important. We need to protect our citizens. We need to protect our tax base, our property rights, our property taxpayers. You probably heard growth pays for growth, and I think the city and their impact fees are trying to lean towards that. A lot of citizens have told me they're worried about, you know, I lived in my established neighborhood, why should I have to pay for that? And really they're not. The growth, the way the city's kind of shifting is kind of paying for itself in a way. That's a simple way to say it. But so citizens can relax, and I think regardless of who is elected here or our current city council, I think they're interested in protecting taxpayers and generating the money. And, again, thank you for your time. Perry, you've done a lot of these events, and so, no, thank you guys for your time.
As I want to start out is, I want to make sure that, that everybody knows that November 2nd is the day that you vote for your city council. But early voting is open now. And I think that's an important aspect that, that we have, is we have the ability to allow our voices to be heard. And that, that voice is the loudest on the local level, on the city council level. Here locally, the things that impact our lives on a regular daily basis, you, the citizens of the Twin Falls have that opportunity on November 2nd. So I hope that on November 2nd, I'm that individual. And so what the way I like to tell people who I am, I like to be a problem solver. I like to solve problems. That's why I went into engineering. I also like to think about what the impacts may be in the future, what that means for my family, for your family. My kids are growing up, this is our home. And so being involved in the city council and the city process and seeing what that future looks like for us as Twin Falls residents is fantastic. But also knowing where we came from, knowing that the individuals that came across in the early 1900s established this great city, and understanding that root of where we came from as an agricultural community, and continuing to show people that agriculture is important to this region, but also the city of Twin Falls. And investing in our infrastructure and allowing our citizens to have good water supply, good roads, good wastewater, our ability to meet some of the environmental and regulatory burdens that are in our future is important. And I believe that a problem solver, somebody that can look at those objectively and subjectively to go and solve those problems. And so, again, vote November 2nd, if not earlier, and hope it's for Jason Brown.
Thank you for answering all my emails. I appreciated it. Tolerated that. I want to thank Time Series and CSI for putting this on, because one of the things I've heard going door to door is some people just don't know how to find out information about us. And so I appreciate you taking the time and effort to allow at least some exposure for all of us so that the voters can make informed decisions about who they are voting for at the ballots. Hope that people do watch this and read about us and don't just vote for the last name they saw. I, being a teacher in Twin Falls, I'm trusted with the youth of our city. I'm trusted to be the caretaker, be the counselor, sometimes provide them with food, sometimes have to give them the advice and educate them, and expected to provide safety if necessary. So already being trusted with you, I want the citizens to provide me the opportunity to be trusted with the city. Also, being an educator, I'm already held to a higher standard of expectations on how I behave in public, what I do in my personal life. And I will also bring that over to the council if elected. And I've been to several city council meetings over the last year and a half. I like to believe that I'm educated on what the city's currently involved in projects and where they started, the projects that new councilmen will be expected to be informed on or to provide their understandings on the situations. And so I hope that the citizens to Twin Falls will take that into consideration, that I am aware of what's going on in the city, and that they vote for me and Patrick Patterson on November 2nd or early vote. And thank you.
Thank you.
Everyone.
I really appreciate everyone being here, speaking off camera, voice coming to you. I do have notes here to talk a little bit about the process if you want to get involved, so I thank you all for referencing it. Yes, November 2nd is election day, 8 a.m. till 8 p.m. at your polling precinct in your community. You have to look it up. But if not, you can vote early. We have 2 weeks of early voting. It started yesterday. It runs through Friday the 29th. Every day, 8 a.m. to 5 p.m. at Twin Falls County West. That's where the DMV is at. If you're not registered, you can register when you go if you have proof of address and an ID. Or always bring that ID if you're going to show it when you vote if you're already registered. Doesn't matter where you live in the city of Twin Falls, you go to that same location to early vote. On the day of, you've got to find your specific spot. Just a reminder, it's a nonpartisan election. So when you go there, there'll be no party labels next to anyone's name. You have to know who these folks are to make your choice. And there is one other seat not listed on the ballot this year. It's uncontested. Incumbent Chris Reed, you will not see his name appear on the ballot due to some changes in state law in 2020.
Yep.
So, and that's all the info I have.
Yeah, I just want to thank you everyone again. I appreciate you doing this with us, and good luck everyone.
And real quick, due to a small technical glitch with the internet on the question number one, which during the introductions, we lost a little bit there.
Okay.
So I don't know, would we like to go ahead and do a second round of introductions just to make sure that we get everybody's...
You want to just make sure everyone's...
You know, it's not a bad idea just to go down at the end of the video and everyone say who they are very briefly again.
Yeah, we can do them in brief. We'll start with since we started to do the first time. All right, round two.
Yes.
So I'm Patrick Patterson. I'm 31 years old. I'm a teacher here in town. I work over at Magic Valley High School. I teach government history. And in my summertime, I teach over at Juvenile Detention Center. I am running for C1, and hopefully you vote for me. And I'm excited to be here and excited to participate. Thank you.
Jason Brown, running for C1, Twin Falls City Council, native Idahoan. Grew up in the Treasure Valley in Caldwell, married my wife. She grew up in Oakley here in southern Idaho, and so Twin Falls is the place that we call home. It's a place that we raise our two kids together. I have a daughter that's a freshman at Twin Falls High School and a son that's a third grader in Sawtooth Middle School. Worked for the city of Twin Falls for 8 years in the engineering department as an engineer. Took a job just recently with the Twin Falls Canal Company as the company engineer there. We love Magic Valley, we love Southern Idaho, and all the opportunities that it provides our family into the future, and look forward to receiving your vote on November 2nd.
Craig Kelly, 46 years old, my wife's a school teacher, my son's a junior, way older now if I said that. He's a junior at Twin Falls High School. Lived in Magic Valley my whole life. Went away to school at the University of Idaho and came back to work in my family business, Kelly Garden Center. I work for Trinidad Venom right now. It's a bean company. So I'm engaged in agriculture in our local community. I'm running for C1. I'm excited to be here and excited about the process. The political process is awesome, so I'm glad everybody's involved, and thank you.
James Pearsall. I'm married to one beautiful wife, and I have three children. They're all under four. I'm 28 years old. I graduated from Filer High School. I'm a native Idahoan. I grew up a short time of my life in Napa, but most of it was spent in Emmett. And then during my junior year of high school, I moved here. After I graduated, I spent 4 years in the Army. And I got out of the Army, and I did federal contracting for wildland fires. And after that, I moved over to hauling milk locally for a local business. That's pretty much my history. Thank you.
I am Tara Rueda. I have been in the Magic Valley for most of my life. I went to elementary school all through graduation in Wendell, and then I moved to Twin Falls and have been here ever since. So I'm very familiar with the area and how much we've grown. I've been a real estate agent for about 6 years, and I've had a lot of different roles as far as policy counsel with Head Start. I've been a CASA volunteer. I've volunteered at my kids' school. I do have four sons. Two of them graduated. I have one child in charter school and then one also in the public school system. So I've seen both sides of that type of system, and I love this valley and would love to see it protected.
All right. Thank you, everyone. Debate on.